Hey, it's ShadowACS again. So given that I've already done a review of the anime Little Busters as well as its subsequent sequel, Little Busters Refrain, I suppose it makes sense now that its 8-episode OVA, Little Busters EX, has completed, to do a review on that as well. I've mentioned in the past that I typically dislike re-reviewing anime in general, but this OVA surprisingly offers a lot of noteworthy material to talk about. And hey, it's still a show done by Key, the Masters of Emotion, and I have no problem returning to their work for another review. It should be said that if you haven't seen Little Busters or my reviews of it or Refrain, you're probably going to be lost during this video. But with all that said, let's dive right in and take a look at Little Busters EX. Okay, so a bit of background on this OVA. After the success of the Little Busters visual novel, Key decided to release an expansion for it titled Little Busters Ecstasy, which this OVA is based on. The expansion added new story arcs for two of the side characters, Sasami and Futaki, who didn't get them in the original game, as well as one for a new girl named Saya who was exclusive to the expansion. Ecstasy is also noteworthy for being the only Little Busters expansion to include hentai scenes, but don't worry, there's none of them in this OVA. Which I'm especially happy about because the girls in Little Busters look way too young for that kind of thing to be comfortably watchable. Aside from one or two images being a little racier, it's basically the same as the rest of the show in that regard. As for whether or not I liked EX, I definitely did. Even if it doesn't connect much to the rest of the show, it's still an anime based on a Key visual novel, and that's something I've yet to see done badly. But the reasons why I liked it are a bit different than why I like the rest of the show, which I'll go into in a bit. Also, it's important to note going into this OVA that you do need to have seen seasons 1 and 2 first. While the story arcs in this seem pretty independent on the surface, there are several important twists where you do need to have seen the ending of Refrain for them to make sense, so just keep that in mind. In terms of what it's about, EX flows pretty much how you'd expect given the expansion it's based on, in that they just show the three bonus story arcs about Saya, Futaki, and Sasami in anime form. And as far as the individual story arcs go, here's what really stood out to me. The story arc with Saya is freaking unbelievable. In my opinion, this is just as good as Clannad. Which is really interesting because, on the surface, the setup sounds like the most batshit insane thing this show has ever done. And that's saying a lot considering the twist ending to season 2. So the idea is that apparently at Riki's school at night, these evil shadows called Executives of Darkness roam the hallways, and our main girl Saya is some kind of super secret agent sent to dispatch these Executives of Darkness. One day, Riki discovers Saya fighting off these evil specters, and Saya decides Riki now knows too much and tries to kill him off, setting up deadly traps all around the school. But when Riki manages to avoid several of these deadly traps, Saya decides that Riki must have luck on his side and insists that he partner up with her. And believe it or not, it only gets more bizarre from there. Apparently underneath Riki's school, there's this giant deadly Indiana Jones-style labyrinth, which supposedly has an incredibly valuable treasure at the end of it. A treasure which Saya is trying to get. And of course she takes Riki down there with her. While the two try to navigate this trap-filled labyrinth, Riki and Saya both start to get a vague sense of deja vu that the two of them might have shared a romantic history together. One that might have possibly ended in tragedy. So how's that for an unforgettably weird premise? But despite how bizarre it is, it still manages to be really emotionally engaging. And the keystone that makes it all work so well is Saya herself. I can say without hesitation that this is the best character this show has ever had. In fact, I'm really sad they tucked her away in this OVA. She is so likable and so funny that it's impossible for her not to just instantly win you over. Her constant mood swings are just flat out hilarious. In a split second, she can go from cold and badass to serious and emotional to flustered and panicking and then back again. And the dramatic moments with her are just perfect. This is Key doing what Key does best. She has an incredible backstory that I won't dare ruin for you. And the romance between her and Riki had me straight up fanboying over it. Which is a very difficult thing to get me to do. I know technically this romance shouldn't work since it kind of cuts in on the relationship Rin and Riki had in season 2. But you know what? I like this one so much better that I'm willing to let it pass. You feel every single emotion that goes into this relationship. And I also really like the fact that it's more of a subconscious romance. The two aren't consciously trying to get together, they just naturally feel that way because of their hidden past. And even if they can't remember why they feel this way, the emotions are still there, and they can't stop them from coming out whenever they're together. In my opinion, this is the best part of Little Busters, as well as one of my favorite emotional parts of any anime, period. I don't even know what else to say, I just loved it. And then the other story arcs happen. And don't get me wrong, they're good, I'd even say they're almost as good as the ones from season 1. It's just, man, after that part with Saya, you really feel the difference. The story arc with Sasami, in keeping with the tradition of weird-ass supernatural ideas, has her turning her into a cat whenever she's around anyone but Riki. So she begrudgingly has to work with Riki to find a solution and figure out why it's happening. There's not a whole lot to say about this one. It's cute, and being key, they do manage to work a surprising amount of drama into it. But there's nothing about it that's especially great either. At least not compared to what this show has done in the past. The story arc with Futaki, on the other hand, is probably the lowest point of the entire show. Which is not to say it's bad, there are actually some really good things in it. It starts with Riki and Futaki having to work together on various projects, and Riki tries to convince Futaki that she should loosen up a bit and stop being so hardcore and controlling all the time. And the conversations they share are actually really good, they wouldn't make this story arc for me. It's just, didn't we already see Futaki go through this same development in the first season? Don't get me wrong, they acknowledge she's a nicer character than before. But still, why did they feel they needed to have another story arc addressing the same thing they already did with her character? On top of that, the direction this story arc goes in the second episode is really lame and cliched. I won't give it away, but it's about as textbook bad romantic comedy as you can imagine. Not to mention that again, it only serves to drive home a point that we already saw in the first season, that Futaki's family is a bunch of assholes. We know, why are you spending time rehashing stuff we already saw? Come on guys, you're key, the guys who made Clannad, you can do better than this! But let's be honest, the whole reason to see this OVA is the story arc with Saya. And on that note, I was still more than happy to see it. In fact, I'd almost say start watching Little Busters only to get to this story arc, it's that great. The other story arcs definitely have their good points as well, but Saya is more than enough of a reason to recommend it. This is ShadowACS, and I'll see you next time.